Welcome at this general information round for the English taught bachelor program International Business Administration, taught by Rotterdam School of Management, the business school of Erasmus University. My name is Adrie Meidam. I work as executive director for the two bachelor programs that we offer as a school. We have the big one in Dutch, taking around 1,000 students per year, Bedrijfskunde in Dutch, Business Administration translated. And we have the English taught one, International Business Administration. This session is about the English taught one. We have a crowded hall, but still, there are way more people watching at this moment than you might be aware of. Maybe it's good for you to know that this session is live streamed and that it can be watched all over the world at the same time. We know from the intake from last year that we have quite some students from Asia, especially from Indonesia, Taiwan, China, Vietnam, also upcoming, Thailand, a lot of other Asian countries. And I'm pretty sure that quite some of them are watching at this moment. For them, it's Saturday afternoon, so if they're not hanging around in a bar somewhere in Ho Chi Minh City or in Bangkok, they might be watching. But anyway, for all people watching us on the live stream, welcome. Good that you're virtually with us. Actually, it also gives the right tone, the right sense. We are very much an internationally operating program. We take in a lot of international students, so this program is kind of global in all senses. And so, very much welcome to all of you who are watching live. Still, you are here. I expect most of you will be from the Netherlands, because, well, that's next door, so to say. But I'm always curious if you do also have people in the house who came over from abroad from today. Can I see some hands? Yes, quite some. That's very good. Much appreciated that you've made the effort. Maybe it's good to start with something we found out when we did a little survey among our first-year students. So we started with a big group again last September, and after a couple of months, we asked them a couple of things. If they've been well informed about the processes, the application, the program, the students, etc. But we also asked them, why did you come to us? Why did you choose to study IBA at RSM? They gave multiple reasons, but two reasons really stand out. The first reason has to do with the reputation of the school. And reputation can be translated, ranking, accreditation, perhaps also the job opportunities that you have when you qualify from a school of this reputation. That's one I'll come back to. The other reason, equally important, because of the international character of the program. And that's certainly a truth. I can already tell you, when we started last September, we took in around 550 students, and they represented no fewer than 60 different nationalities. So you can safely say, at IBA, the world is in your class. We have some big ones, of course, but it's also good to know that the Dutch are a minority in the program. They are the single largest group. Around 30% of our intake comes from the Netherlands, or is Dutch, or speaks Dutch, but 70% is non-Dutch, and mainly comes from abroad. Some big ones, we have quite some Germans, some French, some Italians, Spanish in the house. Then we see people also from Belgium, Indonesia, China, Canada, the US. We try to cover all the continents as much as we can. So for Australia, we need to make some additional effort, but still we're very happy that we have again all the continents in the house this year. So it is about reputation and about the international dimension. So what are we going to do today? First, when we talk IBA, International Business Administration, what are we talking about? What is the field of studies? What will you learn with us? Then, why would you choose IBA at RSM? I already gave you the two main reasons, but still we will be elaborating a little bit on this one. Then, we will take a closer look at the content of the program. Which courses will you exactly get in the program? How much flexibility is there, etc. And if we have time left, there's also time to ask us some questions. Still, we have a booth one floor down, in which we have a lot of people, trained students, ambassadors, who are very eager to answer all your questions, and I will go down there as well after the presentation. So, what are we talking about when we're talking business administration? If you take a closer look at many companies, regardless what kind of sector they are in, you will quickly find out there's some similarities between companies. You will find out that they will produce a good or a service for which they need resources. And actually, this is an area that is commonly referred to as resources, supply, and you can also try to be professional in this to save costs when you organize things in the most effective manner. And you might also be keen to get top resources for the products you want to produce. This has to do with the functional area in business that we refer to as supply chain, operations, logistics. It also includes efficiency in making movements where you need to ship goods, etc., most efficient ways, transport, logistics, etc. Such an area we refer to as a functional area in business. You will also find out that marketing is always there. Actually, you can be able to produce a fantastic good or a fantastic service, but if nobody ever hears about it, you'll be left with all your goods. So you need to promote. You need to be present in the newspapers, but more important, on the website, to have the virtual reality within reach. It's very important. So marketing is a very important functional area in business as well. When you talk marketing, you talk sales, because actually someone needs to sell the product that you have produced and also make a good price of it. Of course, IT data, key in any company, becoming increasingly important year after year. There's no world, no marketing, no running of a company without data. And actually, every business school is also required to make you data savvy, as we call it. So you should be able to work with data, to correctly interpret them, to work with them, to draw conclusions from it. It's a very important field, and the same holds true for companies. When you talk business, you talk money. That's a similarity also with the economics program. Money is always a very dominant factor in everything a company does. In the end, you want to increase your turnover and make a profit, which is important for a company, otherwise you will not survive in the market. So, bottom line, a starting question could already be, how do I finance the startup of my company? And if you want to be an entrepreneur, one of the first questions, how do I get to the money? Will I look for investors? Will I do fundraising, crowdfunding, whatever? Will I start working with stocks? Will I go to the labor market, etc.? It's a very important question. And also, you need to keep a good notice, keep the book, so to say, on what you're spending and what you earn in order to find out if you're really making a profit. So accounting, that's the more formal word for bookkeeping. Accounting is always very present in companies. Communication, promotion, marketing, finance, accounting. In the end, there's always people in companies. So when you work in a company, and most companies will work with people, that's commonly referred to as the field of HR, human resources, the human resources that you have as a company. And human resource management is a sector that's always visible in any company. What you see in business schools, now what you see in companies is also what you see in business schools. If you would make the effort to compare the various business programs all around the world, you will roughly conclude, they're doing the same. They will teach you a little bit of finance, of accounting, supply, logistics, accounting, etc. These functional areas are always there in any business program. And they're important for various reasons. One of the reasons is that you will see in many bachelor programs in business that they take a broad approach. And that's also what we do as a school. We've chosen to teach you a little bit of all of these functional areas in the bachelor program. So 2 years of the program are fixed, I'll show you later on, in which we do the basics of finance, accounting, marketing, human resources, etc. That's a solid foundation for any further step that you might make. In the third year, there's some differentiation, I'll show you later on. But then, after the bachelor, the choice is yours, and you can go for a master's. And you will quickly find out that most master's programs are specialized. And those specializations are in many cases one-on-one with those functional areas. So indeed, as a business school, as RSM, we have a master's in finance, a master's in accounting, a master's in marketing, a master's in human resource management. So these functional areas in business, they do matter. Also for the next reason, it's very likely after you've graduated from a business school that your first job will be within one of those functional areas. So you will start in a marketing department, or you'll work at a bank, or be in the HR department, etc. So it's very likely that your first job would also be in this field. Still, having said this, and maybe, no, we know some statistics, of course, as a business school, it's very likely that around 5 to 10% of the people present here will strive to set up their own company, so they try to become an entrepreneur. We also know in this audience, around 4 or 5 people might end up as a CEO of a larger company, probably a multinational, we'll see in the future. Then you will also find out something else. Because actually, of course, in business, you need specialists who are very good in their respective area, in their own functional business. But still, if you want to properly run a company, it takes more than that. Because every functional area, every department has its own interests, so to say. So you might be approached, for instance, when you're in charge of a company. So when you are a CEO, you might be approached by the people from the marketing department telling you, we have developed a great campaign to promote our product all over the world, including the faraway markets. We have a great plan. It will cost $2 million, but it will pay off, and we will sell much more, and it will improve our reputation. Then the decision is up to you. Are you willing and able to spend $2 million? And the next day, the people from the supply chain enter and say, well, we have found fantastic, great resources, and we have found the up-to-date, the latest standard machinery to produce it. It comes at a price, it's $2 million, but it will pay off. HR will say, actually, no company can flourish without having the right people in the house. So actually, we're very keen on hiring the people, the best people we can. Okay, this comes at a price, but then we have top people, and we'll make a profit. If you do all this, you'll be bankrupt within 1 year as a company. So actually, it's both in the hands of the entrepreneur, but also of the CEA, to kind of balance these different functional areas, to say, okay, I want to find a reasonable balance, a reasonable trade-off between what we are required to do from the marketing perspective, from the supply perspective, and to keep an eye on costs and to be able to still make a profit and increase turnover. So it's important when you're in charge, when you've kind of developed a bit of a helicopter view or an umbrella view, those of you who would really like to run the company should be very much aware that these sectors, these functional areas, they matter. But still, it's also very important to have a view on the whole, and that you should be able to balance the different interests. Only when you do so, you can be successful. So actually, you might expect then, in a program like business, that you will see a little bit of those functional areas, and that you'll see a little bit of this integrative approach. And actually, this is true, which you can see on one of the following slides. There's also another thing I should mention. When you took a look at companies, when you took a look at business schools, but also for MBA programs, the professional programs, you quickly find out that making a good turnover, so increasing your volume, so to say, and making profits was the key driver. It was the most one prime important thing for any company. However, times are changing. You read in the newspapers, see on the television, you see on the internet that we are challenged by global warming, that sustainability has become an issue, that there's also societal responsibility. Okay, you can increase your turnover and increase your profits if you work with child labor, because child labor is available and cheap in India. But do you want this as a company? You may be aware that Volkswagen faced a huge scandal a couple of years ago when they manipulated data, and of course they did so in order to increase turnover and to increase their profits. But is it acceptable from a societal perspective? We see that companies are changing. Already 4 years ago in the Financial Times, you could see from one of the big insurance companies who was insuring the shipping sector and the oil sector, at a certain moment they stopped with insuring cargoes and traders who did not sign the contract to reduce carbon dioxide. So it was a very important signal. Last week we saw on Dutch television that some large companies in the Netherlands said, we stop investing money in polluting activities. And actually one of the Dutch pension funds has retired from one of the big companies in the Netherlands because they want to make a statement on reducing the carbon footprint and making use of fossils. So it's changing. And it's also changing for business schools. So this is one of the main reasons why we have said as RSM, we're going to change, redefine our mission. What do we want to stand for as RSM? And we found a new one, and we have defined it as RSM wants to be a force for positive change in the world. That brings some responsibility, because actually, then it will not be enough that you teach your students the latest in business, but that you also create some awareness of the things going on in the outside world. Which is important, and it will have an impact on what we teach, because of course we can teach you the principles on profit making, etc., but we'll also teach you what is happening in the world out there and how to take a stance. Our aim is to deliver graduate students from our bachelor program who are good at two things: have a great knowledge of the business sector, but also have a personal mission, a personal message. We expect that quite some of you will end up in a position in which they're able to have influence on what happens in the company, around you, in the neighborhood, in the country, etc. And we hope, and that's really our hope, that you will take with you the message of the school, that you can both serve the company, but also can serve the society by thinking about the choices you're making during your studies, but also after your studies in the labor market. So we are a school with a mission. Then, as already said, one of the characteristics of IBA is its international approach, and actually this shows off in many respects. As already said, it very much shows off in our students. As said, we've started this year with 60 different nationalities, and that's a stable pattern all over the year. So there's a lot of diversity, and in this way, we're also kind of creating our own human lab. Because actually, what we think that might happen for some of you, let's say in the next 10 years to come, then you may find yourself somewhere else in the world, maybe in the United Arab Emirates, and you're on a project together with local people. The Chinese will be there, I'm pretty sure, some other nationalities as well. You're under pressure, you're in a strange country, in a different climate, different food, you're not talking your mother tongue, most likely it will be in English, and you need to be successful in the project. And you need to work with people who are different, with different opinions on what, for instance, time management is, at what hour we start in the morning, different habits on how much time you will take for lunch, different habits on working with timelines, targets, payoff, but also providing and receiving feedback. And you will find out this is important if you want to be successful in the arena of international business. We know the stories in teams. We do a lot together with our big neighbor, with Germany, and it's easy cooperating with the Germans because you see what you get. It's very frank, it's very open, very straightforward. So if you're with a German student in the team, regardless if it's a company or with us in a working group in the program, and you think that your German colleague didn't do a proper job, you can frankly tell him and say, well, it was not good. Actually, it's a bit crap. You should improve. And most of our German friends will say, okay, I'll improve, and they'll come back to you in a week with an improved proposal. I would not recommend you to deal and operate in the same way with your Chinese colleagues, because if you would tell them, this is not good, this is crap, you create damage forever. And it will be very difficult to still successfully cooperate with this Chinese colleague in the future. It's important to have this knowledge about cultural sensitivity. And if you want to go for an international career, you should be aware of this. Our privilege as a school, as a program, is that we're able to kind of simulate the future position already in the program. We bring you together in a very diverse and multinational group, and you will be put in working groups in which you need to work with people with different backgrounds, with the Germans, the Italians, the French, the Americans, the Chinese, and you'll find out. In the beginning, everybody's very enthusiastic. Oh, this is great, this program is so international. I see people from all over the world, etc. But then the work starts, and then, yeah, honeymoon time is over, and then you learn that sometimes it can be challenging to stay, to be successful in a group that's so different. And a bit of a natural reaction in some cases could be, maybe you should stick to my lensman. Actually, that is the last thing that we want in the program. We want you to go for the confrontation, for the challenge, and to find out how to successfully work with people who are different, because that's a vital component of the program. So, why would you study at RSM when you've concluded for yourself, oh, this field of business, that's something for me, and actually also like to be in this international group, and maybe I go for an international career? Why would you choose us? Because there are thousands of business programs all over the world. There are also thousands of international business programs. So why would you choose us? It's important. No, let's say it in a different way. If you just want to go for a career in business, every business school will do. Because as I said, they will roughly teach you the same. The finance, accounting, marketing, so that's not the difference between business schools. So the difference is how recruiters from HR departments in companies look at graduates from various schools. And you may accept from me that quite some companies have a bit of a shortlist with them somewhere here, and that they prefer to recruit people from certain schools. The shortlist is around 40, 50 schools worldwide, and it's important to be on the shortlist if you really want to go for the top. How do they know? And how could we know, how could you know, what is really a good business school? Well, there's a couple of indicators for that. A very important first one, are you internationally accredited? And accreditation means that an external organization checks your quality, does a proper evaluation, and if you meet the requirements, you can get a stamp, a seal, so to say, okay, you're qualified, you're getting this accreditation from us. Every school in the Netherlands, like many national systems, is required to have the national accreditation. So the Netherlands is the NVAO, the Nederlands-Vlaamse Accreditatieorganisatie. That's an accreditation you need as a program, otherwise you're not entitled to teach and to deliver diplomas. So everybody has that. The international one, that's an extra one. It's optional. And not every school, not every program is going for that. But those schools with international ambitions, they go for that. There's many of these accreditations, but three really stand out and are very important. The first one is AACSB, which is the American accreditation. It's very common in the US, it's less common outside of the US. That's one, AACSB. The second one is its European counterpart, EQUIS, from the European Foundation of Management Development. Takes a more international approach, which probably explains why very few American business schools are EQUIS accredited. Currently, it's only one or two or so. It's more common in Europe, but also in Asia. It's still a bit of an elite group, so not around 100 schools worldwide. That's the second accreditation that matters. The third one is AMBA, that's the British one. Actually, you can safely say every school that is accredited by at least one of these organizations, EQUIS, AMBA, or AACSB, you can be sure that's a good school, because the procedure to be accredited is pretty strict, and not every school makes it. So that's one, are you internationally accredited? And actually, if you would take a look on websites, and when you would read the Financial Times, you see the advertisement of business schools over there. Schools will never forget to show this little logo that they are AACSB accredited, or EQUIS accredited, or AMBA. Go check it, they're always there if they are accredited. So that's one. The second one, are you in the rankings? Those overviews that are published on a regular basis by newspapers, magazines, websites, etc. There's tons of them, many, and not all are that important. But in business, it's flourishing business, so to say. So with the Financial Times, the Business Week, the Wall Street Journal, the Neue Karriere, the Economist, there's many of them. The funny thing is, regardless how they measure, we're always in. And normally they put us at a good place. We think the most authoritative ranking is the ranking of the Financial Times. So the financial newspaper based in the UK. Actually, they take a very selective approach and they take very much into account career success. So where are you ending up after you've graduated from a certain school? So that also is a very important criterion in how they work. They'll take a look at the research performance of the school, which might sound a bit far away because you're not looking for research, you're coming for education, but still there's a link because schools who are high in the ranking are able to recruit top researchers, and that reflects in what we teach. So you're able to see top researchers when a school is well ranked. The other nasty thing about the Financial Times ranking, only schools who are accredited by one of these accreditation organizations I just mentioned, by AACSB, EQUIS, AMBA, can be included in the Financial Times ranking. If you are not accredited, you simply are not in the Financial Times ranking. So it's pretty elite. And you will see those accredited schools, you will find them in the FT. So that's the second indicator. Then the third indicator, there's a bit of a saying among business schools that says, tell me who your partners are, I'll tell you who you are. And it's interesting to take a look at the partners list of the various schools. Every business school wants the same. You want to offer your students the best, and every business school has the option to go abroad for a while, to semester abroad for a semester. And the principle you want to send the students to good schools, preferably even better than you are yourself. So every business school is striving to get connected with other schools who are at least as good as they are themselves, and preferably a bit higher. You'll quickly find out that mediocre schools cooperate with mediocre schools, the good ones with the good ones, the very good ones with the very good ones, and the top with the top, and everybody wants to be at the top. If you would now compare which schools do cooperate with each other, which schools are in the Financial Times, which schools are accredited, you'll see it's the same group of students. So there we have this group. 40, 50, 60 groups worldwide. RSM belongs to this group. We are triple accredited, so we have these AACSB, EQUIS and AMBA ranking. We are in the rankings, and we have a great partner network. We will not show the details today, but some highlights, but actually if you take a look on the website, you'll quickly find out that we have a great network of partner schools. We are international, of course, as already said, we teach in English, a logical thing, of course. Maybe also important to mention, we are a research-based school, so of course we take an academic approach, but still we know we are preparing you for a career. This will show off during the program in various courses, but it also shows off in the facilities, the support that we offer. As one of the few schools in the Netherlands, we have our own career center in the house, with specialized people are able to help you first to properly compose a CV of yourselves, how to write a proper application letter, how to get in touch. They organize fairs, online events. They have a huge database of companies that you can get in touch with. So they really facilitate you to help you to get access to the labor market. So that's one of the things we have in the house. Let's take a look at the program then. Well, from what you see, you will not be surprised because you immediately recognize some of these functional areas. You see the marketing, you see the finance, you see organizational behavior, that's in the field of HR. That's typically the functional areas. Still, there are some others who are not so immediately recognizable, so to say. And maybe this is a good moment to turn to one of our students who has already completed the first year. Where are you, Ata? There you are. Can you join us on stage? But could you elaborate a little bit on the first year program and some courses that stood out for you?
Definitely. I'm waiting for the mic.
Yeah, there you are.
It's on. Okay, so welcome everyone. My name is Ata and I'm from Turkey. I'm a second year IBA student. So today I specifically want to highlight two courses from the curriculum you see here. The first one is professional development and mentoring you see on the top. So this course runs for the whole academic year of the first year actually. And as a part of this course, you are put into a mentoring team of around 20 students and your mentor is a second year IBA student. So I have to say that this mentoring aspect really helped me a lot, both in transitioning from high school to university and getting used to the IBA program. And you can imagine that since the mentors are second year IBA students, it's very easy for them to understand how the first year students feel and what they need at the end. So that was definitely one of the best sides of it. And the second one I want to highlight is the strategic business plan. So it takes place in the second half of your first year. And as a part of this course, you are expected to form a team of around 5 students and you're expected to find a company to work together with. And luckily, the company we found was actually initiated by an IBA graduate from 3-4 years ago. It was a company called Sodak. So that was also a very nice opportunity for us to see a role model as the CEO. And throughout the 5-6 months that this course runs, you have multiple meetings with the CEO and the top management team of the company. And as a result, you prepare an extensive strategic business plan considering both the internal and external environment of the company. So I have to say that after completing courses like Introduction to Business, Accounting, Organizational Behavior, and Marketing Management, and gathering all the theory behind all those, this course really allows you to put all your theory into real-life practice. So that was definitely one of the best sides of this course, in my opinion. And also, I want to say that at the end, the company ended up implementing some of the suggestions we had for them in the report. So that was also really nice to see. Yeah, so thank you very much. That's my introduction of the course.
If I ask one question,
yeah,
because you're supposed to come up with an advice for this company, and for this you need information. Were you given access to company information? Because I can imagine that it's pretty sensitive and even secret, so to say, confidential. How does it work?
Yeah, definitely. Actually, I want to say that they created a very nice, truthful environment for us. Like, we were sharing everything together because they knew that that was only for educational purposes. So they shared almost all the information with us and they were willing to interpret all of them. And sometimes if they were not successful in something, they were even talking about in detail with us since it was for educational purposes. And they were also expecting us to give them some nice suggestions at the end. Yeah.
Thanks. Sounds nice. Thank you, Ata, for sharing this information with us. Thanks. Oh, sorry, I should have shown this file because this belongs to your strategic business plan. And I see you, indeed. Yeah. We're pretty strict as university, as business school, so we're in a system which is called nominal is normal, so you're supposed to pass your first year in just 1 year with us. There's some exceptions, so if you miss one or two courses, but you bring a very decent grade point average, you may still get a pass and start your continue your studies in the second year. But we're pretty strict, so normally we expect you to study at regular pace, as we call it. And we've made facilities, of course. We try to avoid risks in this respect, so most courses are not in a way that you are passively listening in a lecture like this for 7 weeks and then have a final exam. That's a bit of a recipe for disaster. So we try to make you work all the time by introducing the option of earning already part of your credit during the course by a midterm exam, by working on assignments, by bonus points, etc. So if there's one complaint from students we frequently hear is that some students say, you make us work all the time. So yes, that's exactly what we want. Because we know if you regularly work, that we can keep up the passing rate for the first year. For IBA, it's always over 85% after 1 year. So this is a recipe that works. We have facilities in place, we have student advisors, we have the mentor program as part of the professional development. So we kind of embrace you, keep an eye on you, monitor your progress just in order to keep the pace. That's how we do it. A second year, Again, some of these functional areas, you will recognize them in the meantime. You see that we have a huge research project. In the end, we are an academically driven business school, so teach you the latest on statistics and the use of data, etc. Professional development, again, continues. We do a business simulation, in which you compete in teams to find out best solutions for companies. There's one specialty I would like to mention, which is right at the right bottom, technology management. That's a course we jointly do together with the Technical University in Delft, some 20 kilometers away from here. These students are studying the sciences or engineering, etc. You're put in the project as IBA students with the Delft or two Delft students. You're working on a patent for your company. You're supposed to present in the end. And this can be challenging because I can tell you, those guys studying in Delft, they're different. They're science guys, engineering guys. It's mainly guys, by the way. And we have a 50-50 distribution. You learn a lot from each other. And sometimes you hear stories, okay, the Delft guys, they do the calculations. So we do the presentation as IBA students. But actually, there should be a little bit of interaction between the two of you. So that's a nice one. Then, as said, we offer a broad program, which means that the first 2 years of the program are kind of set in stone. So no free choice. You just go through it and then you have the foundation knowledge, so to say. But actually, already from your second year, you're able to follow your own interests. Erasmus University offers honors programs, so on top of the regular program, you can study on a specific topic. The university ones are interdisciplinary, so not only economics or business, but also in social sciences and philosophy. We also have our own honors program, which focuses on innovation and entrepreneurship, and even can bring you to a study trip to Silicon Valley in the US. But you can also try to become an ambassador, like ATA, or a teaching assistant, the professional development course or statistics, because you're allowed to have a paid job then next to studies. You can be a member of the case club. That's a group of students competing in teams of four with other business schools on cases that need to be solved under time pressure. So you're locked for 8 hours or 24 hours with a problem and you need to solve it and present it for a company. And we play against top schools all over the world, which is a fun thing to do. We have the I Do project, actually set up by IBA students. They saw our other mission statement. There's a slogan for the school, these black and white pictures you may have seen, I will, and every employee, every student is supposed to have an I will statement. So my one is, I will make you cross borders. You will not be surprised to hear this one. But those students said, I will is great, but you also want to do something. So they created a project which is named I Do. And they set up corporations with NGOs to help and make use of the business knowledge gathered so far to be productive in projects mainly in Africa. And you can earn credit for this in the program, and you can even act as a tutor the year after, and then again you can credit for it. So there's plenty of options in this respect. The third year. The first half is flexible, and as said, the third year is flexible overall. So then you choose to do an internship at a company, or you go on exchange to one of our partner schools, or you take a minor, which is an elective. But you can also choose a full set of electives, so the choice is yours. And in the second half of the year, you choose one out of five tracks. And these tracks do not have the usual common names of the functional areas. We gave them a bit of a different names to indicate a little bit of the profile, and we also capitalized a little bit on your interest. We said, well, if you're interested in this whole production cycle, etc., that's the analytical decision makers one. If you're more focusing on focus and accounting, then we have the performance analyst, and then three more qualitative ones, focusing on human behavior. So what's going on in the brain when you talk marketing, consumer behavior, etc., psychology. We have a global one focusing on sustainability, international business, and the one focusing on the entrepreneurs, the innovators, and the changers in the companies. So in the end, you're required to choose one of these tracks, and also your final bachelor project should be within one of these tracks. As said, we offer you the chance to go abroad. You're welcome, and you refer to the website to see our full list of partner schools. Just some highlights. Bocconi in Milan is very popular, I guess for obvious reasons. ESADE in Barcelona for other obvious reasons. Lisbon also. We see Marshall in LA. That's one of the few US schools that really takes in large numbers of our students because they're also sending large students our way, which is not common for US schools. NUS, Singapore's very popular, but we also have the Hong Kong schools. A lot of the American business schools, the top in Europe. There's plenty of choice to go. Then, at a certain moment, preferably after 3 years, you could be done with the bachelor program, then the choice is yours again. What we see is that taking a gap year is increasingly popular among IBA students. Around a quarter takes a break. But actually, the large majority afterwards goes for a specialized master's, either at RSM or at another schools. And actually, we applaud this when they choose to go to a very good school, preferably one of our partners. So that's up to you. You can also go for a job. That's a minority, because in the Netherlands it's difficult to get to a job with a bachelor degree only, because that's a bit of the habit in the Netherlands. Most employers still have the impression it should be a four-year program, because it was in the past. And a bachelor is only 3 years, so they expect you to do a master's elsewhere. That's not the case in the international job arena. I know plenty of IBA students who successfully landed in a job based on a bachelor degree only. So that's different. It depends a little bit on where you want to work in the future. One of the nice things when you start a job is that you might also qualify for an MBA, which is also a master's in business administration, but it's not a specialized master's. It takes a broader approach. And actually, you can only do an MBA, a master's in business administration, when you've gained a sufficient amount of relevant working experience. So most students in MBA programs are a bit older, around 28 or so. As said, we have a dedicated career center, so we're really able to help you to find your way and to prepare for the job market. You're most welcome to make use of the facilities that we offer for as a school. We have it, so make use of it. Quite some graduated students are still involved in mentoring programs, so you can reach out to a former student of ours to check what kind of company he or she is, and also what it needs to get in, to what is a good preparatory trajectory to land in a job like this student at this moment has. For those of you aiming for a career, a job in the Netherlands, be informed that the Netherlands is a pretty good place for business. You see some indicators, but actually I would say that the world is yours. Feel free to go anywhere. The one remark for a career in the Netherlands, apart from the big multinationals like Shell, Unilever, etc., in most Dutch companies, it's still pretty much of a requirement to be quite fluent in Dutch. And if your plan is to stay in the Netherlands and you're not sticking to the big multinationals, it might be wise to start learning Dutch from the beginning. For the program, it's not necessary. For surviving in the Netherlands, it's not necessary. But if you want to go for a job in a bit smaller companies, then it is a must. Well, we have, of course, strong ties with the outside world. It's both in the corporate world, but also in the public sector, in politics, etc. And it's getting more and more. IBA has been here since the year 2000. So we see our graduates all over the place, and they have an impact. That's what we safely can say. Top employers. What you can see is that the big multinationals, I already mentioned a few, are also very popular as a place to work. So you see the Philips, the Unilever, PricewaterhouseCoopers, Heineken is not only known in the Netherlands but worldwide. You see that consulting is the most popular sector activity to work in. So actually, what our students do in the first year with a strategic business plan, make an analysis, bring these functional areas together, and come up with the proper advice. That's a little bit of a forecast of what a consultant does, because actually that's the main job of a consultant, to come forward, to come up with a good advice for a company. We often get a question, but that's not a question for those of you who are watching this from abroad who are non-Dutch, but if you're Dutch and you talk Dutch, you can also ask yourself the question, why would I choose IBA instead of bedrijfskunde? Well, the main differences are presented here. Bedrijfskunde is, of course, in Dutch. Also, there's an open admission, whereas IBA has a very selective admission. And we have a special session on the application admission process for IBA. We are a pretty selective program. We have to. Over the past 5 years, IBA has been the most popular program in the Netherlands, so we get large numbers of applicants, and we try to pick the right ones, the ones who are qualified and the ones who are really seriously interested in this international dimension of IBA. So join the session on application admission to hear more about the details on the process in this regard. Some practical things. Our normal tuition fee will be around 10,000 euros. However, if you do have the nationality of the Netherlands, but also one of the countries of the European Economic Area, you pay a subsidized fee, which is slightly over 2,000 euros. If you pay the high fee, you can be eligible for scholarships, which is merit-based. So if you performed well and you can demonstrate that you really have a need, you can qualify for a scholarship. You need a visa then. One sentence on that. Do not start a procedure by yourself. That's cumbersome. Normally, we start a procedure and then things go pretty smooth. Last but not least, housing has become a bit of an issue over the past years, all over the Netherlands, also for the other people, so not the students, so to say. So there's one general advice I can give. As soon as you know that you're in for IBA, and you know about the outcome around 15th of April in the current system, go look for housing. Then you can still be able to find a decent place. We have on-campus dorms. We have two. We're building a third one. If you're on time, you stand a pretty good chance to land there. It comes at a price, but it's very convenient to live on campus. Last but not least, there's plenty of ways to learn more about us. The website is a very rich source of information. Actually, every question you might have is answered on the website. We know that by experience. Still, it might be very nice to also join us, like here today on an open day. You can be a student for a day. You can get a campus tour, get in touch with our students. But I would like to highlight this one. Because of the size of the program, we have quite some variety in our students. And you're able to reach out to those students. We call them uni buddies. And chances are there that you'll find someone like you, who is also French, or who also did the International Baccalaureate, or did the Italian secondary school, or has lived in Singapore, or whatsoever. So it's worth browsing to the full group of uni buddies to see, are there any students who I would really like to ask a question, with whom I can safely share my concern? Well, will I be able to meet the expectations for the mathematics courses? And now you'll check with the student, oh, you also did the Abitur. Is it sufficient background knowledge to be successful in IBA? So this one is really warmly recommended. This is really a nice one to try out. In the end, in many cases, the parents decide. They pay, they see their children leaving at a certain moment. We reserved a dedicated part of our website with information for parents. They can read it over again, the reputation of the school, and ask yourself the question, if it's worth the effort, is it a good return on investment, and am I feeling safe, do I have a good feeling when I send my kids to this school, to this program. So that's the parents' part. Then it's about time, but still, the last words are for Ata, because the question is there life next to studies? And I think the answer is yes.
Yeah. So I want to talk a little bit about the extracurricular activities right now, because I think they complement the IBA program at the end. This is how you can make the best out of this truly international environment. Plus, this is how you can practice all the professional skills you gain throughout your IBA journey. Just to give you a bit more insights about my experience, during my first year at RSM, I joined three student organizations. First one was Erasmus Sustainability Hub. I was in the food committee of the Sustainability Hub. And the hub focuses on promoting and teaching sustainable eating, agriculture, fashion, consulting practices. Secondly, I was on the business development committee of Erasmus Center for Entrepreneurship. And thirdly, I was one of the student representatives to become the bridge between the opinions of the student body and the RSM faculty. And this year, I wanted to take it one step further, and I became board members of two organizations. First of all, I am the IBA coordinator at RSM Student Representation, and I am the program director of Erasmus Center for Entrepreneurship. So you might think that so it's really difficult to balance your time with all those things, but if you really plan it well, there's always time for everything. Plus, involving in all those extracurricular activities provides you with a large network and also gives you a lot of problems in the way, which is why we are also studying business. This gives you a lot of opportunities to solve real-life problems and also improve your teamworking skills in international teams. Also, one thing I love about the extracurriculars in this university is that there is definitely something that fits your interests. I mean, from sustainability to culture, from languages to entrepreneurship, from all kinds of different sports to all kinds of music and arts, there is definitely something that fits your interests. Yeah.
Where did you buy that suit?
Oh, that's a tradition, actually. We just wear those strange suits, but like, yeah, you remember us at the end when we wear.
Yeah, I did. Thanks, Anna.
Yeah.
Thanks. Which brings us to the end of this general introduction round. You're most welcome to ask your questions downstairs at the booth, because we need to empty the hall as quick as we can. Thank you so much for being with us. Much appreciated, and have a nice day. Thank you.